Maybe all grown up, you're welcome to come and connect with other families that have been through that process and walked down that road. So that'll be just immediately after the service. Grab some food and meet them over there. And then finally, at 4:30 today, we'll have our monthly 4-H Club, which is our happy hour and history of Highlands Church. So we'll be at the lovely Tidjavas Garden backyard. It's beautiful if you haven't been there. That in itself is a reason to come and hang out with us. Bring a drink or a snack to share, and we'll just talk a little bit about where we've been, kind of where we think we're going, and try to answer any questions that you might have about this community. And I think that there's a map in there in your program, and if not, you can contact Joe Jones, and he'll get you a map. So, without further ado, Ms. Jenny Morgan. not quite the applause you got when you were spent 3 weeks in Italy, but
right.
A little trickle here and there. That's all right.
Well, good morning. I'm one of the co-pastors here, and I have the privilege this morning of welcoming you with the words of our ethos. Married, divorced, or single here, it's one family that mingles here. Conservative or liberal here, we've all got to give a little here. Big or small here, there's room for us all here. Doubt or believe here, we all can receive here. Gay or straight here, there's no hate here. Woman or man here, everyone can here. Whatever your race here, for all of us grace here. In imitation of the ridiculous love Almighty God has for each of us and all of us, let us live in love without label. Amen.
Amen.
Welcome. This week, I read about an Australian nurse named Bonnie Ware, who recently completed some extensive research about death and dying. She works in palliative care. She cares for patients in the last 10 to 12 weeks of their life. And as she walked through the final stages of life with many people, she noticed that most of her patients gained a phenomenal clarity the closer they got to death. She records five common themes, what they framed as five wishes for their life. So people within 3 months of dying often said this: I wish I had the courage to live a life true to myself, not the life others expected of me. I wish I had not worked so hard. This came more from men than women. I wish I had the courage to express my feelings more. Many people, it seems, without always being aware of it in the moment, suppressed their emotions, and they developed bitterness and resentment that actually added to their end-of-life distress. They also said, I wish I had stayed in touch with friends, and I wish I had let myself be happier. Well, what happens in church is supposed to be about how we live our lives, how we do church as a community, how we live day to day with God's help in the real world. But for some reason, it seems that a lot of religion in North America isn't so much about living as it is about figuring out death. Like, where do people go when they die? The North American church is kind of consumed with that question. And then what determines where people go when they die? These questions are legitimate human concerns, but religion might be too consumed with dying and not concerned enough with living. If our religion doesn't help us live well, it can't help us die well. Or we might say it another way: if our relationships with God don't help us live well, they can't help us die well. What can we learn about death and about life from the first century improvisational church? We're living in the book of Acts this summer. It's a 28 chapter book of the Bible that really talks about the early history, the very early history of the Christian faith. The people then used the word ecclesia to describe themselves. Ecclesia means church, and for them, ecclesia meant the people of God gathered as a holy and loving community. They were obsessed with the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They couldn't stop talking about it. They were figuring out on the fly how to live as followers of Christ, and they were imitating what Jesus had been doing and learning to trust that they were not alone in this world. Earlier this month, my co-pastor Mark Tidd talked about Stephen. Remember Stephen? He was the first person killed for following Jesus. Stephen was stoned to death by an angry mob. The way he handled the final moments of his life was that he shouted a prayer at the top of his voice, As rocks were flying at him, as his body was being bloodied and crushed, Stephen asked God not to hold this sin against the people who were killing him. It's remarkable, really. Rather than cursing those people, Stephen called forgiveness down on the torturers who were slaughtering him. Stephen imitated Jesus in life and in death. His religion helped him with both living and with dying. The story of Stephen's stoning falls immediately before today's story. After Stephen is martyred, his friends gently bury his body. And immediately, this raging persecution against the followers of Christ is unleashed, and a man named Saul is right in the middle of it. We'll hear more about him in a few weeks, but for today, on this day, Saul violently ravaged the homes of the first Christians. He would go from house to house and drag men and women out into the streets, and then he would throw them into prison for following Jesus. And the improvisational church spread out as thousands of people were scattered all over the region. A lot was happening. The young emerging church knew something that I think we're just beginning to understand. They knew God is always at work. They didn't take their cues too much from the tragedies they thought they saw with their eyes. They began to experience that God was always more powerful than what stood in God's way. Here's how our story begins today. Now those who were scattered went about preaching the word. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. And the crowds, with one accord, paid attention to what was being said by Philip when they heard him and saw the signs that he did. For unclean spirits, crying out with a loud voice, came out of many who had them, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. So there was much joy in the city. Joy. Joyful people because of their faith in Christ, even during a tragedy. Great joy came to this city in Samaria. Joy that originated in Jerusalem now came to the Gentiles. Joy fell on them, even in a time of life-threatening harassment. So death and discrimination could not stop their joy as Philip entered the story today. Philip was a friend of Stephen. He was one of the men who were chosen to help serve the widows of the church. Philip probably helped carry the dead body of Stephen to the grave. Philip was an example of what happened to the scattered people of God. The improvisational, joyful church was now suffering under murderous threats. Jesus had instructed them to do just what this persecution was forcing them to do. You remember when Jesus told them this: "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and to the ends of the earth." So Philip, now in Samaria, because of this scattering, this persecution, Philip was not a trained preacher at all. He, like Stephen, was more of a dishwasher than a pastor. He was a serving minister who helped care for the widows on behalf of the church. But Philip had experienced the power of the Holy Spirit and the power of the risen Christ, and he had something to say. Philip preached good news about Christ's love and about grace and about all these people being healed. And lives were changed because Christ was with him. Christ, through Philip, was working in Samaria. And playing, you could say, making good things happen in that city and in the whole world. And Simon was one person influenced by the joyful message. Simon Magus was his name, and Magus actually means magician. This magician, who was from Samaria, had been wooing people with his magic until Philip showed up. The city had kind of been under the spell of Simon the sorcerer, Simon the magician. But Philip's arrival turned the spotlight away from Simon, because Philip intrigued the people of Samaria so much so that they turned away from his magic and actually started ignoring Simon. So Simon the magician is impressed. and a little bit jealous, I'm sure. He wanted some of this magic power for himself. The story tells us that Simon Magus believed in Christ, but that his belief was a little too self-serving. He wanted the kind of power Philip had so that he could impress people with these magical miracles. That's what it was for Simon Magus, like an impressive performance that he assumed would produce money, popularity, and power over people. But that was not at all the kind of power that Philip was experiencing, or the kind of power that was sort of leaking through Philip. So Simon Magus followed Philip around for weeks, kind of like a puppy might follow you around. He even got baptized with the other people who wanted to follow Christ. But Simon Magus had a lust for power, and it only increased as he watched Philip. He craved the secret of Philip's power, Philip's magic, which he imagined had a price tag attached to it. Ironically, this power really is free for the taking. Or rather, this power is free for the receiving by anyone whose heart is soft toward God. So Philip just told the story. It was simple for Philip. He had no real plan. He didn't really have any kind of ulterior motive. He just talked publicly about the Jesus Christ that he had experienced. Jesus, who had been tortured and crucified on the cross. Jesus, who willingly died over love for the whole world. This same Jesus, he said, also resurrected from the dead. So Jesus overcame death and then asked his followers to just tell the story. The story of the universal love of God, the love of God for everyone and anyone everywhere. So, not a lot of organizational structure, not a lot of tangible goals, no strategic plan at all. They were operating simply based on Jesus' instructions that went something like this. Talk about me, Jesus said. Do the things that I did. Love God by loving your neighbors, especially your enemies, and I will show up with the power of the Holy Spirit. That's it. No magic, but a lot of life-changing miracles popped up because of Stephen, because of Philip. Wherever Philip went, miracles seemed to happen. Lots of joy, lots of grace being experienced in day-to-day life and even in death for these people. But Simon Magus was power hungry. And so he offered money to purchase these abilities, to try to work miracles like Philip was doing. He could think of nothing but the power and popularity that he might earn. Now when Simon Magus saw that the Spirit was given through the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered money, saying, "Give me this power also, so that anyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit." In the meantime, two church leaders, two key leaders from Jerusalem, travel up to Samaria. Peter and John had showed up and prayed that all these new Christ followers would receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, the true source of the power that Simon Magus was after. Peter and John walked from Jerusalem, 32 miles up to Samaria, because Philip's cross-cultural ministry was breaking new ground. His message was almost equated with denying the people of his own race. For Philip, a Jew, to present the good news on such terms that non-Jewish people would understand and want the love of God in their lives and be drawn to God, well, this was viewed by more conservative views as a betrayal of their faith. The improvisational church was becoming more and more decentralized and more open to anyone. And this was so new for them. They didn't know what to do with it. It must have freaked some people out. And Simon wanted to be in the business of trafficking the sacred power. He thought he could purchase the power to manipulate people and manipulate God. The problem was, the power he wanted to buy or earn really was free. Simon's story shows us the beginning of bribery and the misuse of power in the church. So an epidemic began to spread. I would call it the misuse of grace, the misuse of the Holy Spirit throughout the church. Simon attempted to buy the gifts of the Holy Spirit, but the emerging improvisational church knew this was just not a good idea. So when Peter and John were there, Peter said this to Simon Magus, "May your silver perish with you, because you thought you could obtain God's gift with money? You have no part or share in this, for your heart is not right before God. Repent, therefore, of this wickedness of yours, and pray to the Lord that, if possible, the intent of your heart may be forgiven. For I see that you are in the gall of bitterness and the chains of wickedness." Simon answered, "Pray for me to the Lord, that nothing of what you have said may happen to me." Ugh, not again. Another harsh story in the Bible that we have to deal with. Another story I honestly wish I could just rip right out of the book. But we can't. Simon, the improvisational first century church leader, Peter confronts Simon Magus, who is sort of a half-assed follower of Christ anyway. Peter basically yells at Simon and says, "I hope your money rots in hell with you." Harsh, right? That's really harsh. What happened to grace and love and healing? It reminds me of the time when Jesus confronted Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan." It also reminds me of last week when we read that Ananias and Sapphira dropped dead in an instant. We concluded that we want God to put to death certain things in us. We want God to kill the lies inside us that keep us from full surrender to God's love. We want God to kill the deception in us that keeps us from living in authentic relationship and in transparent relationship and in integrity with each other and with God. But the story is harsh again. So, before we're too severe in our assessment of Peter's harsh words to Simon Magus, or even before we're too severe on Simon the magician, let's consider what happened beneath the story that day. Let's consider what might be happening for us right now. The dangers of false religion were rampant. They were working overtime during the first century. And the improvisational church was to be holy and loving and inclusive of all people. So, exploited spirituality would threaten this young church, the young community. There are times when harsh words are necessary. Like when Jesus confronted Peter. Jesus basically called Peter the devil, Satan, which Jesus did not mean literally, but he did mean it to have a punch behind it. It was a necessary confrontation because of the potential misuse of power. Peter's confrontation today is similar. It's a similar necessary altercation. Simon intended to misuse the power he saw Philip exercising. A misuse of power that would hurt individual people, that would probably damage the new church in Samaria, and that would in some way taint the good news that was spreading wildly around the world. So Peter went after him. Peter tried to stop the abuse before it happened. "You thought you could obtain God's gift with money. You have no part or share in this, for your heart is not right with God. Repent, therefore, of this wickedness of yours and pray to the Lord that, if possible, the intent of your heart may be forgiven." And then there's Simon Magus, Simon the musician, who's kind of clueless. He didn't know what he didn't know. Like, he only knew power. He only knew money. He only knew the desire for popularity. Sometimes it takes God a little longer to help us rid ourselves of certain kinds of diseases. So do you relate to Simon Magus at all? I do. He's leveraging. Many of us have leveraged things or people. Leveraging, that is, in order to get our personal desired result. Think about it. We leverage relationships all the time, and we call it relational connections. We don't want to admit it, but sometimes we acquire power or authority over people through money, by leveraging money. We even leverage the church at times. We say to ourselves, not with our outside voice, but with some inside voice, we say, going to that church would be really good for my business, or my ministry, or my dating life. We leverage many things and many people to get ahead, or to have more money, or to find a better job, or just to look good in public. This kind of Simon Magus leveraging is what we cringe over in banking systems and in government and in certain kinds of business deals. And the contradiction with the good news of Jesus is that the pursuit of leveraging to get what we want divides our hearts, and it redirects our desires away from God. And God wants my whole heart, not just pieces of my heart. Jesus Christ is always at work in our hearts and in the world. So don't take your cues from the tragedy falling on you, or even the tragedy that you're causing or that you think you're causing. Don't take your cues from those tragedies, because Christ is always more powerful than what stands in Christ's way, even when we stand in Christ's way. A line from the priest and poet Gerard Manley Hopkins reminds me of how intricately God is at work in the world. For Christ plays in 10,000 places. Lovely in limbs and lovely in eyes not his. Christ plays in 10,000 places. God was playing in Samaria. Philip, the untrained, uneducated, unordained dishwasher, was playing with God, was God's partner in Samaria. God is now everywhere working, and God longs for our participation as God gently and powerfully draws the whole world into the life of grace, because now we are the eyes and the limbs of Christ in this world. Jesus Christ is always at work. Or in the tradition of the joyful church, maybe we should say, Jesus Christ is always at play. Don't take your cues too much from the tragedy you think you see with your eyes. Christ is always more powerful than what stands in Christ's way. Let's pray. God, help us believe that you really are more powerful than the things we see standing in your way. Whether it's tragedy in the Congo and Rwanda, or whether it's tragedy in our neighborhood, or whether it's our friends that can't find jobs, or whether it's we can't pay our bills, or we're suffering from depression or something that needs to be healed. God, help us to trust that you can work, and actually maybe you work your best when we're experiencing difficult things or difficult issues internally. So I pray that you would help us to continue to trust you and to continue to love one another the way that you've called us to. We thank you and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus took the bread, and as he broke it, he said to his disciples,